Okay, well, welcome to another MedCram lecture. We talked in the last edition of behavioral therapy for insomnia. We went over relaxation technique, sleep restriction therapy, cognitive therapy, and cognitive behavioral therapy. What we're going to talk about next is the part that everybody thinks about when we talk about insomnia, and that's sleeping pills, medications. Now, there's four different classes of medications. There's the benzodiazepines. There's the non-benzodiazepine sedatives, there's the melatonin agonists, and then finally the antidepressants. Now, medications in general do usually improve daytime function, they have better quality of life, there are a few comorbidities, but you've got to consider that in general, especially the benzodiazepines, that there are side effects of addiction with time, long-term use. And also, the longer you use a sleeping pill, the less likely it is to do the job that you intended it to do in the first place. You have more tolerance to these medications. So in what type of patients would these risks go up? Well, in pregnancy, you have an increased risk of fetal malformations. Also, if there's alcohol consumption going on at the same time, in kidney, liver, or lung disease. Certainly, if the patient has sleep apnea, giving them a sleeping pill could make the sleep apnea worse. You really want to be careful in nighttime decision makers, so people who are on the job, people who are watching alarms, things of that nature. And finally, the elderly, people who are 75 years plus. So this is a busy slide, but let's go through this methodically. So we've got medications. There's four different classes of medications. Let's talk about the first two classes, the benzodiazepines and the non-benzodiazepines. So these non-benzodiazepines are very similar to the benzodiazepines, but they have a different chemical structure, as we'll show you. The benzodiazepines in general, and we're talking about like triazolam and some of these drugs like Prosom, Ativan, Restoril, Dalmane, Doral, these all bind to the GABA-A receptors, okay? And they're long-acting. They decrease the sleep latency. That's the amount of time it takes to fall asleep. So they do their job there. But they also increase that second type of sleep, that second sleep phase. Not REM, not N3, but stage 2 sleep. They also increase total sleep time, so that is intuitive. They decrease REM. That's a very interesting characteristic because in patients with REM behavior sleep disorder where REM sleep seems to be the problem, these benzos actually help. Now, these benzos can cause amnesia, and so you have to be aware that they do impair memory. They decrease anxiety. They've also been used as anticonvulsants. As you know, Ativan is a great anticonvulsant. Some of the side effects include daytime sleepiness, motor and cognitive problems with dependence, and then complex sleep-related behaviors. What do I mean by that? I mean sleep sex, sleep eating, sleep walking. There's been many lawsuits associated with people with automatic behavior at night that is related to benzodiazepines. When we look over at the cousins of the benzodiazepines, which are the non-benzodiazepines, and I've got some of their structures down here. So this is the benzodiazepine structure, generally speaking. And this is a couple of the other ones. This is zolpidem, that's a non-benzodiazepine. This is zaleplon. And then finally, azoplicone, which is the same as Lunesta. These three are different in structure to the benzodiazepine. That's why they're called the non-benzodiazepines. But these are probably the ones that you're familiar with. There's Ambien, Sonata, and Lunesta. So these also target the GABA-A receptors, but they're more specific. They're cleaner. They do decrease sleep latency. They do increase stage 2, just like their benzodiazepine counterparts, as well as increase total sleep time, reduce REM, and impair memory. However, they seem to cause less decrease in anxiety, and they're less of an anticonvulsant because of their specificity. In terms of side effects, we see less of the side effects that we do with the regular benzos, such as less daytime sleepiness, less problems with motor, less problems with cognitive behavioral problems, less dependence, and less complex sleep-related behaviors. Now, the other thing that's important is looking at the half-life, which I have listed here. The half-life is important because if you take a long-acting sleep medication and you wake up 8 hours later, you could still have this medication hanging around. So it's important to know the half-life. of these medications. So Ambien's got a half-life of 2 hours. Ambien CR also 2 hours. Sonata is pretty short. In fact, it's the shortest. It's about 1 hour. The way I remember that is a Sonata lasts about as long as a Sonata, maybe a little bit longer. And then finally, Lunesta is very slow. It's longer acting, and I just think of a slow-moving butterfly, if you will. So those are the characteristics of both the benzos and the non-benzos. What I would remember there is that they're both potentially causes of dependence. So be aware of that. But the non-benzos are probably cleaner in terms of sleep medication. Now, recently, this came out in 2013. You should probably know about this. The FDA, which has approved the use of Ambien, Ambien CR, Edular, and Zolpamist, have been FDA approved for sleep, but they were looking at new data. And blood levels in some patients may be high enough the morning after use to impair activities. So again, they're sensitive to these long-acting drugs that can cause high levels of sleep medication in the patient's blood when they're supposed to be getting up. And so as a result of that, they recommended lowering the dose specifically in elderly patients. Now, specifically, the FDA warning that occurred in January of 2013 for Zolpidem recommended the use of a lower dose in women than previously recommended, and also considering this in men as well. And of course, the Ambien CR recommendation was a lower dose. And the quote was here that patients should not drive or engage in other activities that require complete mental alertness the day after taking Zolpidem extended release, because Zolpidem levels can remain high enough the next day to impair these activities. So if this is something you want to take on a daily basis, if you read their recommendation, you pretty much shouldn't be driving. So you've got to be aware of these FDA warnings. Okay, so let's move on. We've talked about one and two. Number three is the melatonin agonists. Well, there's only one in that category, and that's Remelton, Rosarum. And this is a melatonin agonist. It binds to M receptors tighter than melatonin does, actually. Pretty short acting. And because melatonin is used in sleep onset, this medication, Rosarum, is actually good for sleep onset insomnia. So if the patient has trouble getting to sleep, but has no trouble staying asleep, this might be a good medication for them. There are fewer side effects than there are with benzos or non-benzos, and there's no hypnotic problems, symptoms the next day. Now, this is the key point. It's not habit-forming, so it is not a dependent medication. So if you're concerned about a patient becoming addicted to sleep medication, this might be the medication for them. Now, it can increase prolactin and decrease testosterone levels. However, the FDA does not at this point see the need to monitor. So this is another medication that may be beneficial. Again, the antidepressants is the last category. We look at things like doxepine, amitriptyline, and trazodone. And this is what I would say. If you've got a patient who's depressed and they're also having problems with sleep, fine, go ahead and pick an antidepressant that also treats insomnia. But I wouldn't go to an antidepressant as a first-line agent if the patient does not have a psychiatric illness. So these are kind of twofers. So doxepine is FDA approved, but things like amitriptyline and trazodone, these are probably not the first line drugs I would go to unless the patient also was depressed. So if you look at some of these studies here, trazodone versus Zolpidem, there was really no difference. So why don't we go with the one that's actually FDA approved for insomnia? And basically, the sleep societies don't recommend the use of sedating antidepressants if the patient doesn't have a psychiatric illness already. So generally speaking, I would stay away from antidepressants unless there's another reason to choose them. Some of the things that are commonly used that are not recommended in terms of the State of the Science conference that was done, Benadryl. This is particularly not good in elderly as it causes a decrease in alertness, cognitive function, and increases dry mouth. Antipsychotics, there's only a few trials looking at this, and many side effects. Barbiturates, again, few trials, many side effects. Some of the things that are done over the counter, like valerian, melatonin, and alcohol, we've already talked about alcohol. It can actually promote sleep disturbance later in the night because of its short-acting nature. Melatonin is not FDA approved. In fact, it's not even regulated. It's a nutritional supplement. So it can be used in sleep phase delay syndromes, and usually it's a lower dose that's going to help. But again, Rosarum, I think, is the medication that probably would work better. Valerian does decrease sleep latency by less than a minute. No regulation once again. So you don't know how much Valerian you're actually buying when you think you're buying Valerian. It's not regulated. So again, the sleep societies do not recommend it. A couple issues about side effects in older adults. We talked about increase in sleep quality, increase in total sleep time, decreased frequent awakening. However, there is about a 2 to 5 time adverse cognitive or psychomotor event. So we got falls, we get fractures, and that goes up. Interestingly, they did a study not too long ago that showed that mortality went up. Now, this was an observational study. This was not a randomized placebo-controlled trial, so the evidence is not as strong. But it was very concerning that observational studies connected sedative hypnotics and all-cause mortality to as high as an odds ratio of 4.5. So this still needs prospective study data to look at it to see if there's actually causation as opposed to just association. Okay, so what have we talked about? Patient with insomnia, they come into the office, we look for diseases that are easy to rule out. We do hygiene and stimulus therapy. And if that still doesn't work, then we go down the road to behavioral therapy and select medication. Which one do we do first in terms of behavioral therapy and medication? Do we do them at the same time? Do we do one and then the other? What does the data say? Join us for the next lecture where we get into that issue.